On the 3rd of May this year, Justin Langer was appointed head coach of the Australian men's cricket team. I recently caught up with Alfie in our hometown of Perth, just for a chat between two old mates.
Alfie, tell Australia what type of person they now have as coach of their cricket team.
The Australian public and the players now got something very passionate about Australian cricket. I love Australian cricket. When I was a little kid, I was brought up watching Kim Hughes and Dennis Illey and Rod Marsh and Graham Wood. I've been brought up on it. It's just in my DNA, isn't it? My uncle played World Series cricket, Robbie Langer. And so I'm passionate about the game. I'm passionate about Australian cricket. I'm a bit sad where we got a few months ago.
Yep.
And so when the calling came, it was a no-brainer really to take on the project. Keeping in mind, I probably left my dream job actually.
It was going well, wasn't it?
Yeah, I loved it. I loved it because I was back in West Australia where I was born. First time in probably my adult life I'd been back in Perth, living back here for 6 years, going into the Wacker every day. There's only one head coaching job in West Australian cricket and I was lucky to have it.
Yeah.
You could say back then there was a crisis in West Australian cricket. You could say there's been a crisis in Australian cricket with what happened in South Africa. So I've had a bit of a dress rehearsal at it. Hopefully I've learned some great lessons over the last 6 or 7 years in WA. And hopefully I can implement some of those lessons over the next few years in Australian cricket.
What about the frightening side of Justin Langer whipping the shoes off ready for some sort of taekwondo? What was your martial arts? You're an expert at...
Well, certainly no expert.
Black belt in what?
Zendu Kai. I learnt that. It was funny with my dad. My dad was, he was one of the guys he worked with, Johnny Andrew, literally the toughest man I've ever met, my scariest man I've ever met. Well, he used to work with my dad, and dad decided he was going to start martial arts at the tender age of, I don't know, 40, I guess.
Yeah.
And dad went to a few sessions. It was too hard on his back. Dad had a few back operations, and he'd paid for a year. So I said, oh, well, I'll do it. And Dad goes, yeah, don't be stupid, son. And I said, no, I'll have a crack at it. So I used to go to the Sunrise Dojos at 6 a.m. 3 days a week with Johnny Andrew.
And how old were you?
I started when I was about 16 years old. And you talk about discipline. I had to get up at 5:30 to start training at 6 o'clock. I mean, there's a real discipline for a young guy. But then I also learned so many lessons from him about concentration and about facing your fears and facing an opponent. And Johnny Andrew, like, he was just hardcore tough. He'd get sued every time he opened his mouth these days, I reckon.
The other thing with your mind has been your meditation. Is that for clarity or is that for to allow focus or,
well, interesting,
or just to
story.
Relax?
Yeah, in 1993, I was selected to play for Australia and that was the dream. I played 2 tests against the West Indies and it was like the greatest... I'd achieved my dream, Gilly, and then I went to New Zealand and they were selecting the Ashes tour after New Zealand, so there was 3 tests. And in the last test, I got 64 and I batted all day. Now, you imagine that in this day and age, right? What was I doing, mate? And then I remember getting out. Not out overnight. And I got Bobby Simpson
Did someone not try to run you out there?
Imagine doing that now, mate. And
64.
And I got out the first ball next day, LBW, Danny Morrison. Oh, I can't believe it. Second test, I got 20. Third test, I got a pair. So I missed out both innings, right? So I'm thinking, and John Wright, in his 100th test, I think it was his last test, John Wright come up, and he was tough old New Zealander. You know, he probably had a smoke and a beer in his hand. And we're sitting there, he goes, oh, look, I've been watching you, young fella. And, you know, I think you're trying too hard. You need to learn to relax a bit. I'm going... Yeah, okay. Not what I was expecting from John Wright, the tough opening batsman. He said, I think you should learn transcendental meditation. And I went,
whoa, what?
Transcendental meditation? I don't know what he's talking about. I said, oh yeah, right. I thought he must have had too many.
And AB must have been into that, wasn't
they? Oh, yeah, that's right. AB was there and Merv was there and Booney.
Booney loved that.
So I was sort of going, oh, yeah, okay, no worries, mate. I'll learn transcendental meditation, whatever. Anyway, I get home, I miss out on the Ashes tour, 1993 Ashes tour. And
shattered at that point?
Oh, end of the world.
Did you think it was the end of the world, yeah?
Like, when you get something happy, you can't see past the end of your nose, you know? Yeah. It's end of the world. And I was sitting at Mum and Dad's round glass table in our house in Duncraig, and I open up the West Australian newspaper, big advertisement, learn transcendental meditation. So I'm going, no way. This is the second time I've heard it now in a week. So I said, oh, okay, so I'm shattered. Bugger, I might as well give it a crack. Mm. I remember ringing a guy called Derek in Smythe Road, Claremont.
Yeah.
I still remember. Still so that's remember. All that time. Went and met Derek, went back there two or three times, and he instructed me in transcendental meditation. And I've literally, that was in 1993, I've literally been meditating every day since. It's really hard to intellectualise what it does for me,
yeah.
But I know it makes me feel so different. So I suppose it's helped me with focus and concentration in over the years, and yeah, I found it really, really important in my life.
Not that long ago, you lost your best mate
mm-hmm.
and your mother in short period of time.
Yeah.
How did you get through that? What do you learn out of those adversities?
Wow. We go back a little bit. Phil Hughes died as well.
Yeah.
You know, like Hughesy was like my little brother.
Hughesy, yeah.
So Hughesy died. And then my best mate, Billy, just had a heart attack, died.
Mid-40s.
Yeah, 47.
Yeah.
So they were both really contrasting. One, heart attack. Two, long battle with cancer. What I learned, I tell you, I learned that my life's better for having them in my life.
Yeah.
But it's not better without them in my life.
Yeah.
You know, it's a struggle all the time. You know, you lose, and they, in a lot of ways, they were my go-tos. They were my go-to. My mum and my mate, Billy, mm. they were some of my go-tos. But what I also learned about that is that we stress so much about what could happen in the future.
Yep.
We stress, we spend so much on worrying, but you can actually, whatever happens, you can deal with it. You know, like when Billy, like that's the end of the world, but actually you can, there's something in us as people, we can deal with it. When my mum died, like, mate, that's like nothing, there's nothing worse.
You just can't believe it could possibly happen, but.
Yeah, but then when it happens, you deal with it. It certainly adds layers to your character, I think.
Cole, your dad, who you said's a huge impact. My forever and a day, and Cole's still full of life and in and around, the image I always remember of him is him standing at the gate in Hobart when we walked off. Well, every time we walked off in that partnership against Pakistan in 99, that was, he's just been extraordinary, hasn't he? And what an event for him to share.
Well, there's a couple of things on my mum and my dad. Like, mum and dad used to play good cop, bad cop.
Yeah.
If I was a wuss for 1 second, if I was feeling a little bit disappointed or a little bit down, my dad go, mate, do I need to get over there? Where I was in the world, do I need to get over there and kick your backside? And my mum would go, oh, come on, Colin, leave him alone. So it was always, you know, are you all right, darling? So it was always that. Even though dad was the bad cop a lot of the time, the tough one, that test match in Tasmania, in Hobart, he rocked up the night before the test because I was under the pump again. I was rubbish. So, like, I was always under the pump. And I was going to get dropped if I failed again.
He was down there to support?
Yeah, he just rocked up the night before, unbeknownst to me. So he rocks up and then he sat there and at square leg the whole time. For the first innings, I got a few, and then the second innings, obviously one of the great moments of our life. Certainly our sporting life. And then it reminded me of Pat Cash 1987.
Yeah.
I was in England that same year when I played, got that 100. Pat Cash wins Wimbledon, jumps up in the stand with his family. Oh, I'll never forget that moment. So then I had my own Pat Cash moment, you know. Yeah. We're going to win the test match, I walk and there's my old man and he was giving us a hug and he'd come in the change room after. Oh, mate, that is gold. They're golden moments in your life, aren't they?
Yeah. Extraordinary.
I still remember, though, I told my old man a lie that day because I nicked that one off Wazim Akram, remember?
Yeah, we're on the record now.
Yeah, we are on the record. I'm now 10-year rule. I came on the record about 18 months ago, I reckon. I thought, yeah, it's enough time's up now. But I nicked one off on 78 or something. And I walked off. My old man said, hey, you nicked that one off Akram? I go, no. Clicky bat handle, mate. Clicky bat handle.
You know what? I didn't know you hit it. I honestly didn't know.
Maybe I didn't actually. Maybe it was a
cookie. You can't start twisting your story around again. 2004 India, for me, is the highlight of our group's time together. I reckon that sort of holy grail of winning in India, and not just winning then, but the build-up to it and all the preparations for it over a number of years. How do you reflect on the emotions of the highs of that and you know, winning a 2001 Ashes and Ashes victories at home? How do you reflect on those good times?
Well, I can say hand on heart, I remember very little about the actual cricket.
Yeah. Of any of the series?
Well, I remember the celebrations. I remember that. No, I do. I remember the team song. When I was asked to be the songmaster, that was like one of the greatest moments of my life, when Punter asked me to be the songmaster of the Australian cricket team. But
what's so good about singing the team song? Like, I feel like I know myself, what I believe, but what you found so good about winning a test and singing that song.
Well, I think there's a couple of things. One, it's hard to win a test match. The relief when you win, because there's always a build-up to it, then you actually win, and then the best thing is you walk in the change room for a few hours in your life, you're in there with family or friends or some supporters or whatever, but you've actually got the pressure's off. You've just won. So it's always it's one of the things I say in coaching, it's more fun winning than losing. Mm. So then to be in the change room with your mates and sit down, the pressure's off, and it's always nice having pressure off.
Yeah.
And you just talk and listen to music and have a beer. And then when it got back in there, it was like when Johnny Williamson True Blue came on the stereo, and then you stand up with your mates and you sing Johnny Williamson True Blue, and then you sing Kay San with your mates, and you sort of, let's face it, there's nothing like a sing-along with your mates,
right? I agree. Don't you reckon that little period of time when nothing else matters in life, for that little cocoon moment in the inner sanctum of the Australian cricket team.
Yep.
And other people go, oh, you're over-dramatising it and it's boys' stuff, but nothing else matters because you've just achieved something you've all set out to. You've planned for, you've prepared for, and then you've executed that.
It's just a magic moment, isn't it? And in terms of 2004 India, that was my Mount Everest moment in my career. I mean, to win in Nagpur, that was a... And the planning that went into it, and we were so disciplined. We had to fight so hard after losing in 2001 when we could have won. But then to win, that's my Mount Everest moment. That's my gold medal in cricket. That was it. And I said in my first press conference as coach, in 4 years, we play India and India. If we can build it, and we've got a lot coming up. We've got a India here this summer. We've got a World Cup and a Ashes next winter in England. But for me, over the period, if we can beat India in India, that'll know how the team... We'll know then if it's the best team in the world or not.
Yeah.
So because we know how hard it is. So I think we've won there twice in 80 years. So we've got lots of work to do because it is hard. But for me, knowing that's my gold medal, at some point in my coaching career, I imagine that will also be my second gold medal if we're able to achieve it. I remember sitting on the sofa the night it happened, and as an ex-player and someone who loves the Australian cricket team, I was shocked. I was sad, I was angry, I was completely shocked.
JL, here at Perth Stadium, up the stadium, mate, it's something that I'll never be able to answer because I don't think I'll ever end up coaching, certainly the Australian team. What about the emotions on game day when you're in the middle as a player, which I can relate to, obviously, because I share a lot of days with you, but to that as a coach?
Yeah. Well, it's so different, Gil, because one of my favourite memories was singing the national anthem together.
Yeah.
And you know, especially at Boxing Day, I mean, there was nothing like it, was there? So, and as a coach, you're not out in the huddle.
Yeah.
And this might sound really strange, but one of my favourite things about coaching is it's all prepared just before the first ball, getting a cup of coffee and sitting up in the box and having my coffee sitting down. All my work's done by there, and then I sit down and I take it all in. There's not much we can do, but whereas as a player, I was huddle, national anthem, so much pride, you want to get out there. And sometimes I had my pads on, I was opening bats, but then you're flying and your adrenaline's pumping, whereas the coach is the opposite. It's almost like I really mellow down. It's really funny. I have my coffee, I chill out, and I just, because there's nothing I can do. And that's one thing I've realised, it's so different coaching than playing, because when the boys walk across the line, it's in their hands. Our job is to prepare them as well as possible, and then we let them go out and put on a show. When the match starts, whether it's a 2020 game or a test match or a four-day game, I let it go, mate. My philosophy on coaching is that when it comes to game day, we've actually got to try and help our players become a lot more self-reliant become a lot more self-resilient, because when you're out in the middle, you're by yourself. So, and you'd hope by the time game day comes, certainly the great players, they know what they're doing.
Yeah.
But there's a bit of education for some of the younger guys. Sometimes it's an arm around the shoulder, usually, to make sure they're all right for the second innings. But overall, my style would be, I watch intently.
Yeah.
I get quite, you know, I get quite focused on the game with my cup of coffee and my notepad.
Yeah.
But overall, when it comes to playing, it's up to the boys to get out and get amongst it. You've always got to look at the big game. As a coach, you've got to look at the big game. And as a player, you want to do really well in the next game, so you get selected for the next one. As a coach, you've got to take a much broader view of that.
Yeah.
And sometimes that's hard, because you want to win all the time, don't you? But you've got to take a bigger picture. I think one thing that's happened is that because players get paid now, and they get paid well, all of a sudden the expectations seem to grow. And that's not how, again, that's not how the cycle works. It takes time. And
you can't artificially manufacture that
can't.
Experience that,
no, 100%.
That you gain over that journey.
That's exactly right, mate. And because I think, like any job in the world, the more money you get paid, it seems the higher the expectations are, or the higher responsibility. And I really feel for the young players out there, that certainly they get paid well, that's great. But all of a sudden with that comes greater pressure. And it's already, you know, mate, it's a test, international cricket is a really tough school. And then you add the extra layers of pressure onto it. I feel for the young players now.
So, mate, just got to say, from there in the middle, it's a long, long, long way up there to that viewing box way up there, if you've got a zero next to your name, eh?
I reckon Mark Waugh would like to have hit a six up there.
Here we go. The new players... viewing room, is it? Is this coach's box?
Coach's box, yeah. It's gonna. It's different in the BBL final, because you got all the public here. Usually in a coach's box, you're away from everyone, but here it was really quite a strange feeling.
Everything's
actually pretty
accessible from the public's point of view at this ground, isn't it?
Yeah, no doubt about that.
So, mate, it's a new dawn, fair to say.
Yep.
This ground, you as coach. Mm-hmm. You've been around the team for around about 6 months now. Mm. Are you in any position to have been able to form your own opinion on why the results of, or what we saw in Cape Town, firstly was even considered and then carried out?
In terms of the specific, what happened with the ball?
Yeah.
My honest view is it's an international problem.
Yeah.
And it's, and I can't for a single second understand how we took sandpaper out onto the field. That doesn't make any sense to me. What I do know though is that the issue with people, ball tampering, is something that's going on internationally.
Yeah.
And that's a real worry. And the way I think about this is, remember when you were a little kid, you played backyard cricket with your brother and you put the tape on one side of the ball because it had to swing. Because if you don't get the ball to swing, you can't get your brother out. That's a pretty boring game. And I think it's an issue. There's a couple of issues. One is we've got to get the pitches right around the world so that the ball does move, whether it spins or swings.
Yeah.
But to go to the point we did was a huge mistake. I remember sitting on the sofa the night it happened.
Mm.
And as an ex-player and someone who loves the Australian cricket team, I was shocked. I was sad, I was angry, I was completely shocked. All I know is, as a past player and now as the coach, I was shocked, I was disappointed, and I can promise you it won't be happening again.
What's this team got to do to have that engagement with the public again?
We've got to make Australians proud. The way we do that is we develop great cricketers, but also great people. The most interesting thing in my last 6 months is that I've heard almost globally the Australian cricket team's culture is terrible. The behaviours are disgraceful. What I do know is that the players in there are the best young blokes you'll ever see. You know, they work hard, they're really professional, and they're really nice young blokes. They're really good young blokes. So I think you'll see that shine over the next little bit.
Spoken to Buff at all?
Yeah, I have.
Yeah.
Buff's been really good.
Yeah.
He was really sad how it all ended up for sure. Buff, obviously. He's one of the really good blokes in Australian cricket, as we both know.
Yeah.
He and I are so different. We were opposite. It was almost opposites of when we were playing together. You know, I'd be wearing the fluffy white socks and he'd be wearing the old wet socks. He'd be drinking the Coke and ice. I'd be having the ice water and Gatorade or whatever you want to drink. But, yeah, we're very different, but he's been great. I've spoken to Buff quite a bit.
How are you going to measure success?
The man in the street tells a lot of tales. And what I mean by that is that the day after what happened in South Africa, I went to the Fremantle Markets with my daughter, Ellie. And within an hour, and I've been doing that for the last 4 or 5 years, within an hour, I reckon 10 Australians came up to me and they were angry or sad or they could not work it out. Then a few days later, I went out to the West Coast Eagles new facility and there must have been 300 Aussie workers in their high-vis jacket, in their steel cap boots, and they're building the facility. And they're Australian men who work hard and they go and have a beer at the pub at night and they talk about the cricket or footy. I have a pretty good idea from what the Australian public tell me if we've been successful or not.
So it's not a win-loss record, it's...
Obviously, people get judged on winning and losing, but it's a far bigger picture than that. I think it always has been, to be honest. I mean, Australians, there's no point winning and behaving poorly, is there? I don't think Australians respect that. I don't think they like that. We can play hard. We can, as long as we play fair. And I think we've got enough talent in Australia to win enough games of cricket. Hopefully, a lot of games of cricket. But there's more to it than just that. I might get sacked if we don't win more games than losses. But that's the truth of it.
Blame the players.
That's right. Yeah, the players don't often get blamed. It's usually the coach. But what I learned from West Australia is if you have a really strong environment, create a really strong environment. Not only do we have people we're all proud of, you'll build a family environment, but you also win some games of cricket. That's the perfect scenario for me.
Well, I think it's fair to say, not just from mates and family who know you very well, but for the whole Australian public, I think everyone's very, very pleased that you are in the position to take this team forward with all those the values and forming that culture that everyone talks about. So, mate, I wish you all the very best. Thanks for joining
us. I hope we can make everyone proud. Thanks, mate.
Come here.
Good stuff.